Mike Muse is an industrial engineer, a music executive, a political architect. He breaks down the intersection of politics and pop culture. This is the Mike Muse Show.
They say this is a big rich town. I just come from the poorest part. Bright light, city life, I gotta make it. This is where it goes down. I just happen to come up hard. Legal or illegal, baby, I gotta make it.
I never took a straight path nowhere. Life's full of twists and turns, bumps and bruises. I live, I learn. I'm from that city full of young.
What's up, world? It's your boy Mike Muse. Welcome to the episode of the Mike Muse Show. I am so excited to be in conversation with my next guest. I have been a fan of hers for so very long, for all the reasons, right? Way before the world knew her as this incredible force on That It Is Power. And the second season, the spinoff is coming up. We can't wait for that. But I've been watching her from afar. The way that she has continued to persist and to continue rising, she is just a fantastic example of a phoenix rising. And for me, this young lady is just getting started. But let me tell you, I'm talking about the one and only Tori Naughton, but I'm not here to talk about power. I am not here to talk about Tasha. I swear I'm not. She may want to. It's her personal choice if she chooses to, but I'm so excited for the nonprofit philanthropic work that she is doing, that she has stepped up to create Notori Fees. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Mike Muse Show, the dynamic, the talented, and the beautiful Notori Naughton. What's happening?
Hey, thank you so much for that amazing intro. I need to take you on the road with me.
Yo, anytime. Yeah. You're so deserving, man. Like,
thank you.
Everybody in the world, in America, is rooting for you, right? Like, we just love to root for good people.
I so appreciate it.
Yeah, what you're doing right now is the reason why we're rooting. Like, you're using your place of privilege, right? And a place of position to raise awareness. Mm-hmm. In particular, two parts of your hometown, or let me say that back, two parts of things that make up your constitution of who you are. Talk to us about the New Jersey and then the Caribbean roots.
Yes. Well, I am a Jersey girl, you know. Yay. Shout out. Born and raised in East Orange, New Jersey. So as you mentioned, I kind of woke up one morning with this overwhelming feeling that I have to help people who need food right now, because it's not just, you know, coronavirus, getting sick, and of course that's our concern and staying healthy, but what about the people whose kids are out of school? What about the families that can't work right now and aren't getting paid or losing their jobs or on unemployment, waiting for a check, waiting for, you know, it takes a lot to feed a family of four. So one of the things that was important is to try to do something that will relieve some of that stress right now. So Notori Feeds is an initiative through my foundation, which is actually called the Notori's Dreamers Foundation. And essentially my foundation, I just decided I'm going to put my own money behind this, a week of free meals for East Orange, New Jersey, for 100 families, not 100 meals, 100 families, up to four people in a family. So that's 400 meals. So we're actually feeding so many people every day. So 100 families a day, that's 400 meals, for a week, Monday through Sunday. And East Orange is where I come from. So I know how hard it is to grow up, you know, in the urban city. And Newark, New Jersey is one of the cities that I did Notori Feeds. Last week was Newark. This week, right now, I'm actually literally organizing oranges. We're giving food to the UMDMJ and the firemen, and also, yeah, all these healthcare workers, but regular people too, who are just struggling to eat. So that was one of the reasons why this was so important, because we can't just, you know, sit back and like, oh, it's coronavirus. Thank God, I'm good. But what about people who are not? And yeah. I just know, you know, as a single mother, I only have one child. Imagine people who are feeding four kids. So I wanted to do something to support them during this pandemic.
Yeah, I can't tell you how important that is. And this is speaking from somebody, and I've been public with it as of like last week. I wrote an op-ed about it. I had the COVID-19, and so I'm coming out on the other side of it. And so I understand.
Thank God.
No, literally,
well,
thank God.
Thank you.
Thank God for that. So, but I
said, how was that? Like, how did you feel? What was that recovery process like?
That's a really great question. I got to be honest with you. So I wrote an op-ed. I'll be happy to send it to you. I talked about the silence and the pride that Black men have and how we don't ask for help, right? We're very ego mm-hmm. and prideful position. And so I went through
I went through it by myself.
I didn't let anyone know. I really have like this Superman complex. And
as part most of Black men do.
Yep. And so part of the Superman complex was for me to protect myself, but also too, Notorious, I was afraid. And so it was my anxiety, really. And like, and I didn't want people hitting me up every like 5 minutes, like, how you doing? How you doing? Because my job in the media, I was still working. My job in the media was because you know why, Notorious? This is too much information. Mom, if you're watching, now you know the real secret. I can't believe I'm letting this out, Notorious. Like, I've been bothering you for so long. I forgot we have a whole audience listening right now.
No, come on, tell us.
But my mom listens to me every day on my show, and so if she was knows I would have been down for 2.5-3 weeks, she would have knew something was up. And I'm from Michigan, and so I didn't want her worrying, right? That was one of the reasons. And so it was hard. It took a lot of naps, fighting through the breaks, you know what I mean? And the first week, sweats, fevers, chills. The second back half of it, loss of taste and smell. And then having to report about the death rates every day in New York City hospitals, I just kept willing myself, do not go to the hospital, because unfortunately some people come in and don't leave.
And so, don't come out.
So I was more petrified, right? And so that's kind of how it is. I feel good now, like at 99% now, but I'm afraid. I mean, real talk, to go out, I make sure I wear my mask, my gloves. I have to go to the grocery store.
Well, the good thing is, you know, now that you've had it, those antibodies are in your system. So the likelihood of you getting sick again is slim to none.
Exactly.
So you survived
it. That was just mental now.
Yeah. Oh, of course. But you beat it. Thank God. Yeah. And God bless you for, going through that.
So that's why when I saw this, you were doing, I was like, oh, I've got to talk to her about it, because Notorious, what's happening is you're feeling a need, right? Happening right now in the food banks across the country, they're struggling. Yeah. Because what most people don't understand, and you do as well, because you're doing the work, but for our audience who's listening who may not understand, the food banks gets their groceries and their stock, their shelves from the grocery stores or products that are either expired or near about to expire. But with panic shopping, and all the shelves are empty. So there is no ability for the food banks. They're running out of food, which means they have to dip into their already limited cash resources in order to buy the food for the residents. And it's just not enough. So you are filling a fantastic need.
Yeah, and that was something that was important to me, too. I'm also doing Maturity Feeds in St. Croix, which is where my family is from. So I'm West Indian. My father was born on the islands, the Virgin Islands, so St. Croix, which is, you know, a part of me, too. It's a piece of my history, my home. And I realize, you know, people in the Caribbean are, you know, maybe not being affected as much, but we're still, you know, the beaches are closed. People have been getting sick. People need to still be able to feed their families or themselves, and elderly people who can't get out as much.
Yeah.
They're hungry, right? Mm-hmm. So what I'm doing in St. Croix, I actually donated to 4 food banks across the island. These are the 4 major food banks in Christiansted and Frederickstead. And I'm working with Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett.
She's fantastic. Yeah,
she's amazing. She's fantastic. For VI. So she's a congresswoman from the Virgin Islands. And we just connected and bonded. And I mean, we just went to work. I have a week of free food giveaway by the Saboni restaurant. Mm-hmm. So that's coming up April 27th to May 3rd. And I'm proud of that as well. So the same thing, the template we've been doing, I did in Brooklyn. We did it in New Jersey. Next up is St. Croix. And it's just a way to spread this feeling of accountability.
Yeah.
You know, it's like not just, you know, here on the mainland, there's people on the islands, there's people wherever you can touch, try to reach out and touch those people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the food banks are, you know, giving money to the food banks, giving money to the restaurants who can feed people. That is equally important.
It is. And we're not going to get into your politics, so don't do that. Save that for me. But since you brought up... But since the congresswoman, you brought the congresswoman, also too, I know what you're doing is...
You know, I went to school for political science, right? Did you know that?
I didn't know that!
Yeah, I went to Seton Hall University for poli sci. I thought about being a lawyer, child. Let me go ahead and be an actress in a
sense. Yo! You should. That needs to be in your box. Sorry to shout at you, right? I'm like, yo.
It's all good.
That needs to be in your bio. If I would have known that, I would have been like, yo. That's amazing.
I guess it's not in my bio.
Put that in there. In there, please. You have to have a political science background to talk politics. I'll be very clear.
Absolutely. And I'm not like a guru. I thought that was what I wanted to do. at that time, because I was coming off of the whole 3LW breakup. Yeah. So I was like, you know what? I'm smart. I can, you know, I can argue anybody down. So I wanted to do law, actually, and political science just wound up being the area I found intriguing. So, but all working with the congresswoman has kind of engaged that part of me again.
All right, well, let's rock here now. Okay, since we're here, what I was going to talk about, though, was another need you're filling with the $2 trillion economic stabilization package. They allocated in the first round $350 billion for small businesses, but it didn't get to the people that we know and needed the most, right? It went to Shake Shack. Mm-hmm. For the record, Shake Shack returned the $10 million, but it went to Potbelly. They did return it. But they went to Potbelly, Ruth Chris, you know, all these other major chains who really didn't need it. Where a lot of
which
mom and pops, the local
abhorrent.
Shops.
I'm like, abhorrent, what are you yes. doing?
Like, but people what are like, what are we doing? But it goes to like, people like you and I know the soul food restaurant on the corner isn't getting it, right? The mother
yes.
would get it. So for your know, Caribbean restaurant isn't getting it for all the reasons we know why. So mm-hmm. you were able to allocate and give funding for those businesses are so important. Right.
And people don't realize, you know, those are the things that are the glue in our communities. And that's why I wanted to do cities like Newark, New Jersey, and, you know, East Orange, and even Brooklyn. I worked with the restaurant Negril.
Yeah,
Brooklyn.
I know Negril. Yeah, I love Negril.
They got some good food. And we had I mean, we had some curry salmon.
Yeah.
Like, let me tell you, all the food has been good. That's the other thing. We're not just giving out, like, all right, you get two wings and a biscuit.
Wait.
We're getting, like, curry salmon, we're giving pumpkin rice in the grill, we gave jerk chicken, and then we also gave rasta pasta for those who don't eat meat, so it was just a vegetable pasta option with cheese. Woo!
What?
And then in the Caribbean, in St. Croix, the food, we're doing fish, snapper, like, I wanted to give these businesses opportunity to really feed people with from their soul,
oh,
you know,
goodness.
and the funds that I've allocated are to keep these businesses alive. Like you said, a lot of the stimulus package, like the things that were supposed to save us are not saving us.
No.
It's really, you know, disappointing, but also expected and not surprising with the leadership that we have in this country.
Yeah.
So it's unfortunate, but that's why we have to stand up for us. We as people, and for me, I know I'm just one person, but hopefully Naturi Feeds starts this feeling of like, who can I feed? You know, it could be Mike Feeds, you know, wherever you're from, or somebody in Chicago could say, you know what, I'm going to do, you know, whatever. I think it's important for us all to kind of make sure that we take care of ourselves.
Tori, okay, so dead on. But so now you're even going to the notion, as we talk about in politics, like dignity of work. But I'm going to take it a little bit step further. Mm-hmm. The dignity of work is making sure respect the, you know, the grocery store worker, the clerk, right? And not making anyone feel less than due to their station or their positioning. But what you're hitting on to me is you're doing two things. One, you're giving money to the grill and other restaurants or the like, right? To be able to, you know, put money into their bottom line. But you're making sure that people who are in need have quality food. Like, you're not just giving them a cold sandwich. There's nothing wrong with that for those who are
No, and there's
it,
nothing
right?
wrong
there's
with
nothing,
that
nothing
either.
Wrong. But I just love how you're using your privilege, right? And privilege is relative, right? But using your privilege to make sure they're getting a good meal.
Balanced meal. And that's one of the other
That's
restaurants
amazing. That's amazing.
It's a blessing. I feel sometimes it almost brings me to tears. I was just talking to one of the owners of Southern Comfort in Orange, New Jersey. Her name is Rochelle Brown. So Rochelle and I, with my publicist, Carrie, who stepped up when I came up with this initiative, I really feel like one of the important things, you know, with Southern Comfort from Orange, we have King's Restaurant in Newark, and we had Negril in Brooklyn, and then Savone in St. Croix. All of these owners have really understood when I've explained. I just had a call with Rochelle. We're also feeding, today is our community service day. Every Friday is community service. This has been going on all month.
Yeah. Because
awesome. I started with Brooklyn and then, you know, so it's like every week. But every Friday we decided, let's make that, you know, give to, so we're giving to UMDMJ workers, you know, the hospital workers, firefighters, essential, you know, essential workers, but also people who are, you know, in shelters. We gave to Isaiah House. So I wanted to make sure that these restaurants understand we want to give food that makes people feel, you know, substantiated, something that actually they feel full, but also healthy. Because a lot of times when you're in a pandemic or a crisis, you just eat and whatever. Like, if you got to eat pizza every day, you're like, hey, this is what I got to do.
Yeah.
If I need to feed my kids with nuggets from McDonald's, That's all I can do because it's cheap, right? Yeah. But how can we feed these families and actually give them not cheap meals, but affordable, but in a way where Southern Comfort is giving fried fish. You know, they're getting whiting fried fish, yellow rice, and a piece of bread on the side. So,
but that's right. What you're doing is you're removing the, and I've been talking this a lot too on my show, is removing the stigma of needing help, right? And removing the stigma of going to a food bank. If I know you're giving me whiting, perch, a two-piece special, pasta, which I just learned about, by the way, as a Midwest boy.
Oh, did you get
I just learned literally like two weeks ago. Yeah. I was like, yo, what's the Rasa pasta? But you're making them feel like there's nothing wrong with being in a under-resourced moment, because the audience knows this, and you know this too well by following it. We're sitting now at around 22 million unemployed individuals in America. People. Within 4 weeks, 22 million.
Can you imagine if this goes on? We are fucked.
And I think that but that's why we can't be ashamed to ask for help, right? And we can't be ashamed to do that. But so what I want you to do is give my audience some tools, what they can do, because if you're listening, let me help you connect the dots. What Notori has focused on is two things of her identity, which is New Jersey and the Caribbean. I see a little hint of Brooklyn, but all the reasons why Brooklyn needs to be associated, if you live in the tri-state, and what Brooklyn means to culture. But then also too,
if I live in Brooklyn now.
Oh, okay, So that's a part of
my show. Power shoots in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
So I've had the blessing of Power to be able to fund this project.
Yeah.
And Power shoots right here at the Navy Yard in Brooklyn, and I live in Brooklyn, so I'm like, this is part of my home too. I've lived here for 5 years now, shooting
a hit show.
All these little nuggets are not just random. Like Brooklyn is a piece of me. Jersey is a piece of me. The Caribbean, St. Croix is a piece of me. So we got to include all that.
We do. And then, but you're also too focusing on the small restaurants that you like, right? And so for me, the connectivity is you're staying within your lane, right? In the sense of what you can do. I believe a lot of times individuals want to save the whale, right? And like say, and feed all of America at one time. And the thought of feeding all of America at one time is overwhelming. So we do nothing, right? So talk to us about that process and how others can find ways in their own to do this.
Yeah. And I think one of the things they have to remember is, of course, social distancing, wearing a mask. We have gloves. We have volunteers that are helping hand out the food. Shout out to Jason Dotson of Newark, who's gathered these volunteers who are actually, you know, giving the food out, because we need, because not right now, no one's really working. So one of the things that's hard, you start feeling overwhelmed, because like, who's going to help me do this mission that I have in my head?
Yeah.
So for your listeners and viewers, I think sometimes it's just doing what you can in your, you know, group of people. If you know that there's a senior, you know, that lives in your building or something, and you're able to get out and have your mask and do it safely and get a meal, maybe say, hey, do you need me to pick up something for you when I go to the grocery, or bring a few things back? And that's on a small level, but that senior will feel that little bit of love and consideration that you gave. And I have a special place for seniors, you know, and my grandparents. My grandmother was a nurse in Brooklyn for over 40 years. She was a registered nurse, and she was from St. Croix and came from an island with nothing and built up her family. And here I am. I am her aunt. You know, she basically was a part of why I am the person I am today.
That's amazing.
So I think seniors have to be taken care of, but also, you know, people can do things. Make sure that you pay attention to the information and don't misinform. Yeah. You know, social media sometimes can mix up a lot of information where we just start hearing, you know, misfired and miscommunication and misinformation.
Yeah.
Let's be more responsible about what we post, about what we do. So your listeners can do so much by saying, hey, I read about this. There's a backup. There's a source.
Yeah.
Know that, you know, this is how, because I've been hearing things, you know, COVID, the virus dies, and if you, you know, in heat, and I'm steaming and all that helps.
Of course.
But you just have to make sure that you know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Let's try to be more responsible.
Yeah.
So that's something they can do too. But with other things, it may not be through money or feeding. giving time, like if you live, you know, depending on if you live with others, if it's safe, that's the other thing. You know, just try to give your time and energy to the people who are, you know, alone, because it's the hardest thing to go through this alone.
That is
the part that, you know, so let's try to reach out, FaceTime each other if you can't be together. Love on each other. Yeah. Really love on each other.
That is so great. The tour note, I cannot think of a better way to end that conversation than love and loving on each other. This is really what we need. Tori, as I close this out, hold the line really quickly. Ladies and gentlemen, Tori, how can people go to Notori if they want to support?
Yes. Please, yeah. So if you follow me on Instagram, there's a lot of information at Naturi4Real. That's N-A-T-U-R-I, the number 4Real. And then also follow my foundation, which has all the info on how to get to Naturi Feeds, which is a website, naturifeeds.com. So that's N-A-T-U-R-I-F-E-E-D-S.com. And it opens every night at midnight. So if your city is right now, like if you live in Orange, New Jersey right now, go to Naturi Feeds at midnight. Pick your options. There's a fish option, a chicken option, and a vegetarian option. You can put in your address and we'll have it delivered to you. So please follow me on IG, but also go to the website, NaturiFeeds.com.
I love that. Ladies and gentlemen, that's the amazing Tori Feeds. Now you see why I have been a fan of hers for so long. I love her movement. I love what she's doing. Go support.
Thank you.
What's up, world? It's your boy, Mike Muse. Welcome to another conversation of the Mike Muse Show. I am so excited that you have joined me for this conversation. I literally am excited for this one. It's rare that I get a chance to interview people who kind of fit my intersection. It's kind of rare that I get a chance to talk with people who are using their place of privilege. And privilege is wide-ranging. Privilege is, in most cases, is access in order to create change, social constructs, to create movement, and to really own their agency. As you know, my truth is I used to feel really self-conscious of who I was, right? I never wanted to reveal really my truth. I never looked at myself as an activist because I wasn't the guy who was marching. I wasn't the guy who had the clipboard in the corner. I was the guy who did the fancy dinners and the fancy concerts to raise money for causes and politicians and for change, and to where somebody said, Mike, if it wasn't for the work that you're doing in relationship to others as well as a collective, these individuals wouldn't be elected to office. These organizations wouldn't have the money they need in order to impact the community that's at large. And listen, I have a fantastic duo today that is using their access and their privilege in order to make change in a very dire need of what we are in this global pandemic known as COVID-19. This is my first father and daughter duo, and I think it is a special father and daughter duo. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Richard Weitz and Demi Weitz. What's happening, people?
Oh my gosh, I'm smiling so much. That was awesome.
We're so happy. We're big fans of yours. We're so happy to kind of talk to you. Thank you for having us.
Man, no, I'm super excited to be in contact with you guys. I am a huge fan. Just to set up, Demi, I got so excited to talk to you and your dad. I forgot that the audience may not know what's happening. So the reason why Richard and Demi are on this show right now is Richard is a partner at William Morris Endeavor, which is one of the number one talent agencies in the world. And what he's done is, through his living room with his daughter, Demi, they've created a series of must-attend, if you can get the Zoom link, concerts that have some incredible people doing some incredible performances in their living room. And it all started with Demi. Demi was turning 17 years old for her birthday party, and her dad is just the coolest dad, I think, in the fucking world, and decided to get, like, his peeps together to create this. And so here we are. Demi, I just want to start with you. There is this, I don't know if it's a biblical phrase or this parable that goes, "The child shall lead thy way," right? So talk to us about you being the child, i.e. young adult, that has created like this must-attend event that is actually raising money now for great causes.
Mm-hmm. So this has been the craziest experience of my life, but I would not change it for anything. I first want to start off and say I'm really grateful for what has happened and feel really privileged to be a part of this and to give back. So it started with my 17th birthday party. My dad's friend, Dario, he plays the piano. He lives in Chicago, and my dad wanted to help him out. So he hired him to do a surprise birthday party for me. So I gave my dad my friend's phone numbers and like got together like 50 of my friends, and Dario was playing some songs for us to entertain us and just have a good time. But my friends weren't really into it. I loved it, but I felt a little uncomfortable because all of my friends were like watching me, not really knowing what was going on. So I was like, Dad, like, thank you for doing this, but can we please like do it another time, like turn it off. By the way, Dario's the best. So my dad texted Dario, hey, can we do this for an hour? Like, Demi's friends aren't really like understanding it. We'll get some of my friends together.
Yeah.
So from there, my dad sent it to his high school friends, his friends now. There were like 50 people on, and his friend Debbie Gibson started singing and hanging out with us. And then one of our best friends, Melvin, invited John Mayer as well. So John Mayer, Debbie Gibson, and Dario were hanging out and singing. I got a little happy birthday song in there. It was really, really fun. It was the craziest Zoom, the weirdest night, but it was unforgettable.
Because John Legend was saying how much, I'm sorry, John Mayer was saying how much he loved Debbie Gibson when her first album had come out, and he was a fan. And then he started playing on the guitar out of the blue with her, and she's like, are you kidding me? And it just started becoming like this chat of two people who had never met, who of course people know. And then Demi got
I'm just witnessing this.
Ultimately, thanks to Dario, so he started playing Gravity, and John chimed in on the guitar, and you don't ask them to do it. And then I said, you gotta sing happy birthday. So Debbie and John say happy birthday to Demi. And then Demi said, will you sing New Light? And he did.
So the next day, I'm like, well, that was fun. Let's do it again with Dario. And I started to expand the Zoom, and I invited some people from work. And I was like, well, who can we get? So I called Rick Springfield because he was a natural, given that he has hit songs and also has a guitar. And he's like, what is this? I'm like, just get on. So he was drinking some wine. We're all drinking. I started interviewing him a little, and this is kind of how it started. And he played Jesse's Girl. And then Boy George was on, and he played Karma Chameleon. That's what he knew. There was a delay with Dario because he was trying to play it with him. But that was super cool. And then I go, we got to do it again. And so we waited a couple of days. It wasn't until Wednesday that Josh Groban did it. And I had told my friend and legend, Clive Davis, you got to come on this, Clive. You got to come on this. And he was in Palm Springs, so he was local. He was, okay, fine. So Josh started off, and he played Bridge Over Troubled Water, and then he played another Simon Garfunkel song called America. And I was having other clients and friends on it. Tina Fey happened to be one of the people who were on. She was putting her daughter to bed, but she was listening to the Zoom. And I'm only saying this because it was reported of, like, Groban, you're killing me with Simon Garfunkel, America. And then Clive chimes in and starts talking about his relationship with them. And I asked him how he signed them and the meaning of these songs. And it started to become a conversation with Josh and Clive. And then we wound up having other artists on that night, which really was the beginning of what became where we are today. Another group that was on is one of now our really great friends. Michael and Tanya Trotter, who are known to everybody else as the Warren Treaty.
They're the best people ever, the kindest and sweetest. And
most talented, and they become great friends. They call me the sniper, because I would just call them at any moment and just FaceTime them. And he couldn't believe it, because I had LL Cool J was on, and they were talking, and Rev Run, who's a good friend, and he's like, are you kidding me? And he couldn't believe that Rev was on, because he's such a Run DMC fan. And LL, I wound up just calling those guys with Rev, and they've now had conversations, and LL has been talking about them. And it really started to become what I've called the new wave of community. And that's kind of what these Zooms have become. We can get into the other people that have been on it. I don't need to kind of put everybody in one fell swoop, but it's really run the gamut of anyone from legendary artists to Broadway performers to, you know, current superstars that, you know, are on all genres of music, mm-hmm. which has really been the best part about it.
And as we started, going back to your question earlier, as we started gaining a lot more momentum with this, I understand that this is not normal. It was awesome how this kind of came to be. And I said to my dad, actually my whole family was having a discussion, and I was like, we have such an amazing platform, and what we're doing is incredible. It's giving a great sense of community. Everyone feels connected during those really lonely times, but I felt really helpless at home. There was like nothing. I was doing nothing. I was rewatching my old favorite TV shows. I was like, Dad, we got to raise money for charity. We got to do something. Like, we have this platform. We got to make a difference. Let's just try it. So I made a GoFundMe for our Saturday concert one day, and an Instagram called RW Quarantunes, where I've just been like posting little things about what we've been doing. And I posted the GoFundMe. I talked about it on the Zoom. I kept like posting the link in the chat. I thought we were going to raise $10,000. I made a goal for $30,000. I didn't even think we'd get there. By the end of the Zoom, we had raised $30,000. And then within the next 20 hours, we had raised $100,000. And it was unbelievable. I could not even explain it. So now, every week, we've been picking different organizations. And that one was for the Sabong Community Clinic. And then we did one for the nurses and employees at Cedar Sinai. And we just did one for United Way, which is a global organization. But we did the LA United Way one. And we raised $640,000,
wow,
which is up in total, wow, for all three different charities. And it has been unbelievable and so humbling. And I can't believe this all started with my birthday. But
well, Demi, with that being said, though, Demi, I'm going to talk to your father, Richard, about the intersectionality of the guests that were there. But what I'm enjoying about you, Demi, you remind me a lot of myself when I was in high school. Just a go-getter. I was always trying to solve the world. I was always trying to lend a helping hand. And I'm wondering, I'm going to go from a shallow, but then I'm going to go to a substantive perspective. How popular are you now that you had John Mayer performing at your birthday party? Because he's one of the artists that your father has mentioned that I have yet to see perform in person. So to have you perform Your Body is a Wonderland, like, I'm totally jealous of you right now. And I was homecoming king in high school. So talk to me about the popularity of that of you right now.
It was the craziest experience. Like, the popularity with, like, school or, like...
Yeah, yeah, just, like, this, like, your social currency now. Like, I know your kids are like, how did you get John Mayer at your birthday party?
So, it was all of my dad's friends, yeah, on the Zoom for my birthday party, and I invited my one friend who we had on it, and we were just, like, texting, like, oh my god, this is the coolest thing ever. We were freaking out, and I would tell some of my friends about it, and I would, like, send videos. But as it started getting bigger and bigger and bigger, I became more private about it because, yeah, it's not like me to go and brag about this. Like, I am so grateful. This is the most incredible opportunity ever. But I really, really try not to speak about it,
yeah,
with – I don't know. Like, I have my friends that are supporting me, and it's been so incredible. And I invited them on to the most – recent Zoom. I also invited my teachers on, and it was so touching to see them on there. But for me, I've made so many amazing relationships with some of my dad's friends and some of the musicians, and it's been incredible. But there hasn't really been any, like, popularity or, like, social aspect to it, because that wasn't really the point of it. And I really, really don't want to, like, brag to people.
Yeah.
But as people come on to them, when I explain it to them, I don't really, like, give it the oomph that it actually, yeah, has. When people go on, they're blown away.
Yeah.
But it's been really, really awesome.
I love how you said that. And I wanted to be able to express that because I didn't want people to get the wrong idea, right? And so I wanted people to hear your constitution. Talk to me a little bit, Demi, about your generation. Do you guys feel the weight on your shoulders in order to create change and to help be a solution here in America? Because your generation is taking on a lot. I see you guys are really at the forefront of activism. You guys are really becoming to be at the forefront of making movements happen, like across our nation, right? Mm-hmm. Do you feel not so much that pressure, but I guess do you feel like this nation, this democracy is as much as yours as it is ours? Ours meaning your dad's age and my age.
Mm-hmm. It's been incredible. My school has a lot of very more like progressive classes. Like I'm in one called Critical Race Studies. It's been the most life-changing class ever. And we're learning so much information. And my friends are really, really, really smart and intelligent, and it's really hard for us to stand back and do nothing. So all of my friends before the quarantine and now during the quarantine, we have been trying to make change. We go to all the marches, all the women's marches, all the marches against for like gun violence, a lot of environmental marches. My friends are really, really involved with that. So it's been awesome to see how we can come together and kind of show our own opinions and really fight for what we believe in. And we're growing up in a time where we feel like it's appropriate for us to speak out, and we want to share our views and we want to help. So it's amazing. Like my friends and I like to be very involved with things.
I love that. And it's activism in your own way, right? It's how we started out the conversation, Demi, in terms of like, I never saw myself as an activist. And so I realized that I could use lifestyle in order to move and broaden out narrative of social change. And so, Richard, I'm coming to you now because for me, music has always been my constitution. Music has always been my foundation. And music is always how I've seen change, right? So, Richard, I've done a couple of TED Talks where I've outlined my muses for my work are NWA and Billie Holiday, right? Billie Holiday using that song Strange Fruit to really protest lynchings, right? NWA using that song Fuck the Police to really talk about police brutality and dehumanization of blacks, especially within South Central Los Angeles. And so music has always been the soundtrack of revolution. Music has always been this healing agent, right? And so for you to have all those intersectionalities, Richard, of not only performers, but backgrounds and genres and age, talk to us about how coming together in that moment was both a healing moment, right? As music is healing, but then also too as a way for advocacy, right, in order to promote change through helping and assisting others in need.
Well, I think a little background about me is that I've been an agent. I grew up in Philadelphia, and I started almost 30 years ago, and I've been an agent for going on 26 years now. And I started a television lit agent and represented writers who were on TV shows like Friends and Frasier and Larry Sanders, and then kind of migrated years later when I left my agency, ICM, where I started and started the beginning of this company called Endeavor. And we really believed in curiosity. And with that curiosity allowed me to represent actors and directors and producers, and my passion has always been music. So when we merged with William Morris, it really gave me the opportunity to start to dive into having relationships with the music department and the artists. And once I've met everybody, I kind of just keep them in my Rolodex, and I stay in touch with everyone. Everyone knows that I just like to know people, and I've said this before where I don't think I've ever said no to anybody, and it's now finally coming back to benefit me and everybody else. I started as a fan, and I'll die as a fan. I like all walks of life, all genres, from country to contemporary music. I mean, look, I've been a huge Barry Manilow fan and Neil Diamond fan, and I represent Josh Groban, who couldn't be even more contemporary and incredible. But I also grew up as an R&B loving music lover, which I'll get into in a minute. But I started to collect producers and people that I grew up with. So whether it's David Foster or Clive Davis or Jimmy Jam, Diane Warren, these are icons at the time when music was really music, when it was about the melody, it was about the song. And when you start to peel away of the songbook and the amount of people that they have worked with, written for, produced for, I mean, Clive, just his Netflix special is the most incredible documentary ever, just outlining from Janis Joplin to Earth, Wind & Fire to Milli Vanilli, okay, but of course Whitney Houston and all the things that have come in between, whether it's Luther or P. Diddy or Babyface, right? You know, the amount of people that he's had. And so for Clive to be a mentor and a friend over those last 13 years has really allowed me to expand other relationships. What ultimately I've done with that is I've taken that and had a philanthropic side to myself. I've done very well as far as clients are concerned, because it's all about the clients and what I do. And I've used that knowledge and that experience and that stature to allow it to help other people. And so I have been chairing or co-chairing several organizations over the last 10, 12 years. One is Chrysalis, which gives people a second chance, whether they're incarcerated or homeless, and we give them business practices and clothes and ways to be able to get jobs. And people, you know, in Skid Row in Los Angeles, that's really, really bad. There's other Skid Rows, they're all bad, okay? This is drug infused, and so we, you know, they allow people to get hired, whether it's sanitation or janitors or whatever it may be in the city of Los Angeles. It then migrated to the Saban Community Clinic, which used to be called the LA Free Clinic, and that gives healthcare to anyone. Healthcare is not a privilege, it's a right. And so I have allowed Demi and Aiden, my son, along with my wife Candy, we have been very active in that organization. I'll let Demi kind of go and talk about what we've been doing with these families every Christmas. But I was on that board for 14 years, and they asked me 6 years ago to be the president for a two-year term. And I said, yes, that's the most that anyone's done. I'm now my sixth year. And so it's been incredible to kind of be part of that. And that's how Demi really decided to bring in donations and helping the clinic. And the last one I've recently done happens to be Cedars-Sinai. I chaired the gala for the Board of Governors the last 2 years. Now, the Board of Governors has 750 people on it, so it's not the intimacy of this, but you realize that you want the connections to any hospital. I do, especially here, not only for my family, but for clients or anyone. And I was saying this to someone the other day. I think I've helped four or five people probably save their life or their family's life, whether it was a kidney that needed to be had, someone needed an operation, someone needed the right doctor care. And so being involved with that really gotten me to talk to the top of the food chain. And my repaying that was getting John Mayer to play at the gala, and this year Josh Groban. And what I try to do with my clients is incorporate them in causes that are good for everyone. I'm not doing it just to push people to do something. John Legend just did one for the Children's Alliance this past March, was the last actual benefit that we've had. But what you realize from these relationships and what you're doing is you're building community. And for me, I'm building relationships outside of just my day-to-day work. Mm-hmm. And that has been the most fulfilling. And I think what we can talk about from what these Zooms have been, what I'm trying to teach Demi.
And we've been also curating like the Zooms with what my dad was saying, to like feel good music and comforting music, another way to bring that sense of community and just connect with people. Like there are people on the Zoom call I have never met, but everyone's talking in the chat, and you see people dancing, and you see people laughing. You also see people crying. It's really, really emotional, and the feelings you get out of it are just so strong, and that you feel so connected and bonded to everyone. That my dad and I will get on the phone with someone, and they feel like I know them, and they feel like they know me.
Well, that's been the most rewarding thing. And I would say this, Mike, that how it started is, and I said this earlier, I'm a fan of music, okay? A fan. And so I know what people like. If you have a party, you don't want to hear all just one genre. The reason why people love certain DJs is because they play it all. Whether they play Africa in the middle of Super Freak, and if they play a little OJs, and they play, you know, whatever they want to play, you know, Return of the Mac, you're like, okay, I love that. I mean, when I throw Sheila E. in or Mars Day in the Time, you're like, all right. Those are my jams. And so I started to collect these relationships, and I can't thank enough Clive and Jimmy Jam, who is connecting me to Jeffrey Osborne, who connected me to Freddie Jackson, who I was mentioning to you earlier. I reached out to him. I'm like, I need an R&B night. I'm reaching out to Patti LaBelle. I need Brittany Howard. I need Emily Sade, John Legend, Yolanda Adams. Like, I got Babyface. Mary J. Come on.
I'm screaming, Richard. Stop. You're hurting me.
What I want. But what also is incredible is to be able to introduce new emerging artists.
That's important.
So Ronnie Jerkins, another friend, has an artist that we're working together named Jack Ross.
Okay, I gotta stop you guys just for a second, because you guys are just you keep killing me with excitement, right, of all the things that are happening, and not because of the artists that you're dropping, but because of what music for me represents, right? Like, your music, music and math are one of the two entities that are the universal language, right? Like, 1 + 1 = 2 in every language, right? And there's something about the universal language of music where it just brings people together. Richard and Demi, I don't speak a lick of Spanish, but one of my top 5 albums is Alejandro Sanz's MTV Unplugged, right? And it's because when I was listening to it, I felt every emotion that he was singing, whether he was in love, whether he was going through pain. And then I would ask friends who spoke Spanish to translate for me, and everything I was envisioning and thinking about, he was actually singing about, right? And so that goes to the power of music and the unifier of music. You started out, Richard, I didn't want you and Demi to go too far, because I wanted to back up a little bit about, you know, country music, right? Like, I'm a lover of country music. I interview a lot of country artists.
But for me, Brett was on it.
Yeah, I know. I saw the list. And what I love about country music is, Richard, country music goes to the diaspora of Africa. It goes to the Delta. It goes to the Delta of Mississippi. It speaks to the northern migration that blacks took from Mississippi to Chicago on the Blues Trail, right? So it has this arc of Americana that we don't really recognize, but it is being able to hold this oral history of music and how we all come together and sing the songs. And so I think there's a collective bargaining power of music when it comes to that. Before we move on, Demi, to where you guys are at right now, I have a question for you, Richard, because I did a conversation with the executive director of the Grammy Museum. And so what he and I did was we just went through the genres. We just went through the decades, right? And what was happening in every decade and what role music played in the backdrop, right? Whether it was the women's movement, whether it was the LGBTQAI movement, whether it was the civil rights movement, and the music that was coming out during that time period. Richard, as a lover of music, what do you think when historians look back at this period of COVID-19, when sociologists look back at this period of COVID-19, what role do you think music would have played during this particular time period?
Well, it depends on really a broad question. If you look at global citizens, I would say that's one way, which is more pop until you get to the Rolling Stones, and you get to a couple, you know, Billy Joe Armstrong and a couple of people that, you know, pull at the memory. For me, if an historian is going to look at these Zooms and I'm recording them, they're going to say, oh my God, like, as I'm hoping that Johnny Mathis does it this weekend, who happens to be a personal family friend. But when you have Barry Gibb playing and talking about the history of how he wrote Island in the Stream or Greece, or talking about, you know, his brothers in the Bee Gees and what that is. And then you start to get to Spandau Ballet and Tears for Fears and Rick Astley and kind of where he went and how great he is, and people, you know, finding him again, or Marcus Mumford. And then you get to Rufus Wainwright and talk about the history of how people think Hallelujah is his song, although it was a Leonard Cohen song. And you
meet
people. Yeah, people are like, oh, that was in Shrek. Oh, you wrote that song? No, I didn't write that song. But what I love is pulling out the different genres of, as I said, whether it is a Josh Groban or whether it is a Billy Ray Cyrus or a Thomas Rhett, you start talking about and finding people who have done things before. I had the legendary Randy Newman play I Love LA after the mayor of Los Angeles, Eric Garcetti, popped on in a minute. And people are like, are you kidding me?
Wow.
And I had Peter Asher on.
Ah!
I told the story about him and Paul McCartney and how he managed, ultimately after becoming an artist, how he managed Linda Ronstadt and James Taylor. And those stories that Clive talked about, Dionne Warwick and Barry Gibb, you will not find that. I had Mika Costa on today, and she talked about her.
I went to high school with my mom.
Yeah, oh my gosh.
And talked about her 15-year professional relationship with Prince and Jewel being homeless and talking about how she got signed. These are stories that when you talk about, you know, what people look back on, if they watch the Zooms that I've done, I'm trying to, while people are alive and healthy, because you never know what the next day brings you clearly today, Cyndi Lauper doing time after time in her closet. And I asked her before, I had an interview with her before, a couple of minutes before, and I said, you know, from Philadelphia, and one of the bands that I love, which is a local band called the Hooters, they would always, you know, do these high schools, and we had a contest between Cheltenham and Abingdon, where I went to school in Cheltenham. And I said, what happened to La Pina? They you wrote time after time. She goes, well, I work with him now. We're doing Working Girl the Musical, and I work with him. I go, you got to call him. You gotta get him on. She's like, really? I'm like, just call him. So she did. And when we were talking, I said, well, I love this Hooters as well. I'm in here with a stylist because people don't know how to mute themselves. And there he is. Goes, I'm here. We have this tutor. We start to play a little. And we start to talk about, and that brings me back to where my childhood is, where I'm able to talk to people. I mean, you get a chance to interview people, Mike, on your show.
Yeah.
I'm an agent. People are scared of me. They want to protect their own. This is my client. And now if everybody is just saying, yes, manager, there's no territory. This is not a sponsored WME. This is a music lover who wants to help the good of the world with his daughter, raise money, and have people love and share, mostly with a lot of the legacy acts and the people that you and I love. For me, it's drop the ball. Like, what's the drop the mic moment? And you go, are you kidding me?
Literally.
Also, something I want to interject with what my dad said.
Yeah, go for it.
The connectivity from these Zooms are on a whole other level, which I kind of touched upon earlier. But no matter who your name is, what your level of status is, like, people are in their homes. We're in our kitchen. Everyone feels like they're on, like, the same playing field. The music is what's connecting people. It's so powerful. It's feel-good music. It's music, like I said, that makes you cry, that makes you laugh. But it's bringing people together. And I feel like in that moment, all of the bad stuff going on in the world just kind of, it washes away. You feel so good and connected to people. And you don't feel alone. In this time of uncertainty where you feel so, so alone, it makes you feel like you're surrounded by so many people, even though it's through a screen, and it's so powerful and so authentic. Like, yes, sir, like, we know kind of who will be on it, who will be performing, but
people will drop in.
It's so fluid. It's so random.
I don't know who's on. I just know who I've invited and people who, and now we've extended it. It's been a 500 cap. We've extended it so people can donate. But people love it and start lurking through. I never do because I'm only talking like we are directly to you.
Yeah.
So I don't see the chat as much. But people are like, oh my God, did you see this person? See that person? And like we've had, you know, Gal Gadot, you know, the other day, she was on and she wasn't mute. I go, Gal Gadot, mute yourself. People love that. I don't know her, but she's on. And you start to have Amy Adams has loved it, and she's been a champion. And, you know, I love when Rev Run is always interacting, and he just starts talking to people. And LL has been like my co-host a couple of times. But I have this book here that is like the wish list of everyone that I want.
Yeah.
And I start crossing them off because, let me tell you, Mike, I'm getting a lot of them.
Oh, that's so cool, Richard. That's so cool. But
I want to clarify one thing.
Yeah.
We do not do it in the living room. We've never done it in the living room. It's always been in the kitchen because it's closest to the Wi-Fi and closest to the wine, which is kind of where it started.
The Wi-Fi is really, really shaky in our house, so the living room is our meeting room. It's our common room. We're all going in and out. My mom, also watching the rooms and being like a behind-the-scenes type person, is like making lunch with my brother, and I'm grabbing the water in the middle.
Yeah.
It's like, it's so authentic and real. It's like, we're inviting you into our home, whereas everyone else on the Zoom, you don't need to show your face. There's no pressure to do that. But the best part of it is to see everyone enjoying it. They're inviting us into their home as well.
Demi and Richard, you guys have no idea how better you just make me feel. I've been, like, so disappointed in my Wi-Fi and, like, how audience, what you don't know is the backstory of the technical difficulties the three of us were having due to my Wi-Fi scenario. I literally left this little quote-unquote home studio I have to move closer to my Wi-Fi, and the damn Wi-Fi still went out. So I understand about being in the kitchen.
Do you wonder why?
The Wi-Fi in my room does not work,
oh.
so I have to do it in the kitchen right next to my dad who's working and my brother who has to write an essay for his college class.
I'll tell you two things. One, the reason for that is because everyone in your neighborhood or your building, wherever you're living, they're all on the Wi-Fi 24/7, so it's diminished. Most people have a residential or a lower level, and it's hard to get a business one. And so,
there's the tech guy.
I've learned it because I'm watching. And what I love about the Zoom with everybody, they don't care. It's raw.
Yep.
One of the highlights, this is when I knew we had something. We know I'm good friends with Ross Chapin from Sirius.
SiriusXM, yeah.
And,
what up, Ross?
What up, Ross?
We love you, Ross. What's up, Ross? And Ross is the one who said, you know, you should be on Mike's show.
Yeah.
And he invited Gary Del Bate from Howard Stern. And Gary just watched it. And he is such a music fan also. He loved the cross genres. And he was going nuts, right?
Yeah.
And so he wound up talking about it on Howard for 3 or 4 minutes. The Monday after the Saturday Zoom, and that kind of legitimized what we were doing with everybody.
Oh my God. I mean, that's so cool.
That was the drop in my phone.
That was.
Like, Howard Stern just said my name, like, and Demi, and
I don't even know what happened in that moment, but regardless of all of the.
I said to every music manager, see, we're legit. And
then
I got
to
win.
Regardless of all of the publicity and the names.
Yeah,
it's about bringing people together, and it's about raising awareness for the horrific times that are going on right now with the coronavirus. And it's about helping and spreading love and positivity and making an impact for those who need it.
The purpose
of this is to help, and I don't want to stress that. I couldn't stress that more. It's to help, and we've cried so many times on the Zoom. The Disney sing-along special they showed, I talk about this all the time. My dad and I watched it together, and they showed little kids and their families holding up signs saying, like, Mom and Dad, you're my hero. Thank you for being on the front lines, like, to nurses and truck drivers and everyone that is on the front lines right now. And when we did our fundraiser for Cedar Sinai for the nurses and employees, I was able to see it with my own eyes and to see where the money was going to, who we were helping.
Mm-hmm.
And I could not describe that feeling, and I want to thank everyone on the Zoom because I always make a speech, but my gratitude for this is so beyond words that I can't even explain it. I have a really hard time articulating my thoughts, and my emotions really, really come through. And to anyone that's listening to this that has been a part of the Zooms or has donated, thank you. I cannot express how much it means to me and how much it means to everyone that we are helping.
Demi, I'm gonna end with you, and I want you to think about this before I toss it to your dad for his final comment. But I started the conversation out with you, and I'm going to end the conversation out with you. I want you to give my audience some tools that they can do in order to create change in their own way, right? In their own living room, right? Like for agencies or nonprofits that they care about. So I want you to close us out with that. But with Richard, I just want to end the comment with you is because you said something really interesting, and it's about the collectedness of what this moment is. And you said it was a big broad question about what music would be during this COVID-19 and how history would look back on it, but I think you answered it perfectly. I wasn't even thinking about it from the context of what you were saying, but I think one of the greatest takeaways is how it unified. And you mentioned that agents are sharing clients, managers are sharing clients. That's juxtaposed to what's happening right now, Richard, in the medical community. So what you see now in the medical community is that before, researchers would hoard their research, right? And they wouldn't publish it in any journals until like 4 years out, 5 years out, because they wanted to share and hold on to their own intellectual property or the resource that they have. What they're doing now is actually releasing their studies that hasn't been completed yet. They're releasing their best practices, right? Because what they want to do is create this shared community of how to handle this COVID-19 pandemic so that every doctor, every researcher can come on board to help solve, right? So no longer are these lines and walls of me, me, me. Now it's us, and our, right? And so you literally solidified that perfectly to what is actually happening in the medical community right now.
Yeah. You know, I, can I make a couple of comments?
Yeah.
Just before I end, you know, I thought when Kobe Bryant died, that brought the world together like we haven't seen since 9/11. And just the feeling that people had about that. And I thought that's probably hopefully never going to happen again. And then less than 2 months later, we're all suffering. I always feel that I have a lump in my throat about to let my eyes water, because anytime I think about it, when Rufus Wainwright sang Hallelujah and Demi told me we raised $500,000 in that moment on Saturday,
we were bawling.
And was like, I can't believe this. And like, I get choked up, and I'm not one to do that. What really makes me most proud as a father, and as a human being, and it's not the money, because the money now is going to come. You know, I told Demi my goal for both of us, our goal needs to be $1 million. Then we're going to, think we got to reset again. And we're going to get it, by the way. I'm not ending this until we get it.
I believe it.
But the most rewarding is actually answer to what you asked Demi. It's not what her friends think about it. It's what my friends and your friends and doctors and nurses and anyone on the Zoom, what they think about Demi as a role model to their daughters and what she's doing. And the amount of emails that I've gotten about my daughter looks up to her. She wants, you know, basically Demi has now had some fame in this own small world of the people that are seeing her, because a lot of people, it's like television for their kids. They don't know her. And how they praise, you know, my wife and myself for raising her. We have another amazing son, Aiden. That's the joy, okay? When you can hear other people say, I don't know how you did it. Thank you for allowing you to share what Demi's doing. And it's the moment for us that I never thought we'd ever have. And so I'll never forget this moment. And we're making an impact in something that I made the best of it. Like everything else, I always make lemonade out of lemons.
Yeah.
But I'm so proud of Demi, and I'm so proud what she is symbolizing to any young woman today or anybody else. It's really remarkable. It really is. And I love her, and I'm proud of her. I'm going to say that to you for everyone listening to that.
As you should. And as you were listening, as you were saying that, Richard, man, I was literally thinking that one day I'm going to be working for Demi as her political director of finance and doing all her fundraising as she runs for whatever office that she chooses to run for, because I doubled down on what you said, Richard, in terms of I see a lot of her in me, but then 10X, right? And Demi, a lot of individuals, even my age and your father's age, would not have stepped up to the plate the way that you're doing in such a sincere and authentic way. So I salute you for that. You are an amazing young lady. That's why I want to start the conversation with you and end the conversation with you. So Demi, you've poured your heart out actually through this conversation, this interview. Your emotions has shown, your authenticity has shown. And that's why you're having so much success along with your father and the entire family in terms of creating movements right now and raising money. For those individuals, Demi, who may not be interested in music, who may not want to use music as a fundraiser for things, mm-hmm. What advice would you give them in terms of they want to do something during COVID-19? What is one of the best ways that they can just start to make change?
Well, thank you for saying that. And thank you, Dazzle. I'm just as proud of you and what we've created. It's been unbelievable, but I did not think we would even raise $10,000. I don't know if I said that later. So let alone $640,000 in 3 weeks. That's where we are now. It literally starts with one thing, one little bit of hope. It's all about you can make a difference no matter what situation you are in. Any little thing you do, any donation, any mask you make will make a difference. When we did Project Room Key, the money that we've raised will make wellness kits that are $15. And those kits consist of the basic necessities of masks, hand sanitizer,
toothbrush,
like all of the basic needs. So if you're at home and you're bored and you're cleaning your closet and you don't really know what to do and you're artistic, make masks with your shirt.
Yeah.
Try and come up with creative ways to make things. Have fun with it, because those masks are crucial right now. Those little things are crucial. Take what you love and apply it in a creative way to do something with passion and with your heart, and it really, really will show through. And from that, you will gain a lot of support, and one little thing you do can have the biggest ripple effect ever. And something I do want to say is with what we've been doing, the most touching thing is I have been receiving messages from nurses and from people asking me to help them, but nurses have been contacting myself, people have been contacting my dad's friends to send us messages to tell us how thankful they are and to tell us their stories. And to actually hear what is going on with people and to see it on the news and to genuinely be able to watch it with my eyes and hear about it and read it has been unbelievable, and it makes me want to make a change even more. I never want to stop giving, and any little thing you can do will make a difference, whether it's $15, whether you make one mask or two masks, or you figure something out. Do what you love and apply it to make a change, because it's not about me. It's not about my dad. It's not about the celebrities that have been on the call. It's the outcome of what we're doing.
Yeah.
And that's what you need to take away from it. It's been an honor to do this, and I'm so thankful, and I'm so happy to be talking to you. This is like the coolest thing ever.
Divi, that was so beautiful. I don't think myself or your dad could even top that or erase the moment and the sincerity of that.
Thank you.
It's so heartwarming and so comforting in this crazy time, just to see family coming together, just to do something. Mm-hmm. And I think, ladies and gentlemen, that's just a metaphor that family can come together and create change no matter what the scale is, no matter what the cause is. I just can't thank the two of you enough. What a blessing that is, and what good things are coming out of COVID-19 as people really figure out a way to bring community together to make change. That is the show for today. I can't wait to talk to you again soon. Until next time, peace.
I'm the boy in your other phone, lighting up inside your drawer at home, all alone, pushing 40 in-